Hello.
Hello.
Remarkably well.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Gorgeous. No. Thank you so much for home.
Spread
so. Out. Yes, I'd explain it to the people at home. Obviously, they're going to see. Do people still bother you by saying, "Hey, hey, it's Nurse Gladys"?
Yes. They sometimes shout, "Hello, Gladys." That's fine. That's good.
Is it true that they used to pad you up for that part?
Yes. Yes, to a size 26 dress. You know how big that is, ladies.
It's quite big.
Huge. I used to miss chairs and sit on the floor. You know, because of this sort of plastic bottom out about here.
Why was that? What?
Well, because Roy Clark wrote about a big lady who had a bum like the bumpers of a Morris Minor. So they knitted me one in the wardrobe.
but interesting, you had to go along and presumably, did you have to audition for the part and pretend to be someone big before they made you?
No, at the time I was in a farce in the West End, running about in suspenders and, one of those waspy sexy things.
And they
I weighed 9 stone.
Cover her up, and then they did with lots of padding
yes,
and everything.
No, what Ronnie Barker said, we want her head on somebody else's body. So they made me a body.
Really?
I thought they didn't get rid of my head, that's all I can say. It's good fun.
Was it? What was he like to work with, Ronnie Barker? Oh. He says he's a lovely person.
He is a lovely person. Mm. And the cleverest people are the easiest people to work with. If somebody's very clever, they're no problem. It's the ones that are a bit troubled about their talent that give you a hard time. Mm. You know? He was smashing.
What about the bunch you were working with over there on Bread? Because they were...
Yeah, they were fantastic, and they still remain good friends. Obviously, joining the series halfway through, it was very important that they made me feel like one of the family. And they did straight away, and they made it very easy.
Do you
greetings.
Find...
Greetings, fellow Scouser.
But didn't you have... what happened when you were in the street filming with that dear little lady?
Well, we got to the second series and we went back to Liverpool to do some more filming. And because the ratings had gone back up to where they were before Melanie and I joined, we felt sort of vindicated and we felt very confident. And we were filming in the city centre and we were approached by two dears and they inquired as to whether was this the filming for the new series, and I said yes. We're just, look, there's Grandad, there's Mark Boswell, they're all there, look, having a cup of coffee. And she said, are you going to be doing the new series? And I said yeah, we want all me full leathers, I had all the leathers on. And she went, oh well, thank God you've come back because the other Joey's crap.
What did you say to her after that? Or you just
I said, absolutely right. Well, I'm glad I'm back to her. I can't tell the difference. I'm not going to put them out of energy.
But greetings was Joey's word, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah. And the fans got very precious about it because after I joined, I got fortunately, some rather nice sort of compliments from the fans, but also some rather nasty ones and things like, you know, one of the first storylines I inherited was something to do with his tax problems, and I got letters saying, Joey never would have got in trouble with a tax, now you've joined, now look at him, he's in trouble. And he never had a dressing gown like you wore last week. What can I do about that? You know, not me.
Well, your fans are supportive.
The general public get very possessive of characters on television, and they hate anybody to change characters. I mean, when Ronnie Barker stopped doing Porridge to do Open All Hours, there was a national outcry. Mm. You know, they can't have this, it's dreadful. Silly nonsense. And then within, you know, a little while, they loved it. But the general public get very possessive. You know.
But didn't you have people writing, you know, lots of fans writing to you?
Yes.
Claiming you were their long-lost mum and things?
Yes, and that still happens, I'm afraid. It's actually quite sad, really. There's something about my face that people want to claim me. Especially very sad little children who are in orphanages. I've had about 50 letters, either children saying, are you the lady who left me in an orphanage? Ooh. Or are you the daughter I left in an orphanage?
Gosh.
So I don't know what it is about my very common face, I suppose. But, I still get them. I don't know what it is about me. I must have a sort of fit-all face. You know.
Friendly and warm. That's
lovely. Warm, caring. Yes, that's what it must be. They want you.
Well, they don't know me.
They want you anyway.
Well, there are plenty of people who saw you as a sex symbol too, wasn't there? Even
I should
with
hope
the,
so, dear. At my age, somebody must have seen me as a sex symbol.
No, I mean the padding. Even with the padding.
Oh, even with the padding. Yes. Most you men like big women. It's a good job because most of the women in this country are size 16. It's a good job, isn't it? Or they don't be out in the cold.
Yes, quite right.
And because was there a conjurer or something who wrote to you and thought that you were the
lady
who gave
him... Oh, no, that was funny. That was really funny. I got a letter. First of all, I thought it was a wind-up by one of my lunatic friends. It's, this letter started very seriously. I think you're the Lillian, because that was my real name, that that I worked with during the war. Now, all right, I'm past my sell-by date, but that's ridiculous. And we had an act together, me, your mother and your auntie. Now, my mother wouldn't be seen dead doing anything like show business. She thought it was all dreadful and common, you know, so... And he went on to explain this sort of juggling and adagio act that we had during the war. And it sounded so interesting. And then he said, and I've never forgotten you, you know. And I thought, oh, we had a few other things as well. But anyway, I did get, it was very sad. I had to write back and say it wasn't me during the Blitz, no.
No.
But he thought you were his...
Oh, I was it, yes. It's, so obviously this man's had a picture in his head of this girl he worked with, who they obviously did something other than conjuring and juggling. So we decided that was me. So I'm dreading Police 5 because they probably decide I did all the murders in this country.
But is there any programmes, like, say, that you watch sort of obsessively?
Oh, gosh. Well, let's think. Well, only before I came here, my video was set for X-Files. Wouldn't miss that.
Oh,
yeah.
Big fan.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
Are you a soap fan? Do you follow soaps?
Not really. It's when we're working in the theatre, obviously we don't see an awful lot of TV, and so you have to be rather particular about what you want to record. And probably if I started recording soaps, I'd have to record the lot, and there's so many now. So I'm not a soap.
No, I've never been involved with this. We have this thing in the office when we have soap stars come in, and I don't watch any soaps. Mm.
But it just made me laugh about the X-Files, because in the paper today I read that you can get the lady's just got a degree in the X-Files. You could be there too.
Well, I'm going to do a degree in you.
Are you?
Yeah. Graham Bickley.
Really? Oh. What do you know about Graham Bickley?
He's lovely.
Is he?
Yes.
Is he?
To write that.
Oh.
That's all you need to know.
Yeah.
That's it.
That's it.
That'll get you a degree. It would earn a degree from you if you were handing them out.
I would. You get your mortgage from that.
As you're on such good form together at the moment, and what do you want to tell us about the new play you're in?
It's a musical.
Musical, sorry.
Well, it's more of a play than most musicals because it's got words in it. It's not sung through, as they say. So you don't get silly lines coming out like, "Would you like to put the light out, dear?" "No, thank you." You don't get any of that. we actually ask each other. And it's about Graham is married to a smashing American girl called Summer Rongley, but she lives in England now, I may stress.
I'm not really married.
No,
to
not really. Actually. This
character.
Is in the musical.
See, that's how it starts. Yeah.
No,
you had to clear that up straight away. Clear that one straight away.
No good at all. Anyway, they're an American couple who are having a bit of bother with the marriage, and they move into a new flat, and they find some funny writing on the wall. And to cut a long story short, the lady who wrote it was a flapper girl who was desperate
was
to
a
be
what?
A star. Flapper.
1920s, 1930s.
Flapper.
Or dancers.
Yes.
Like,
oh, you are
dancers.
Young, aren't you?
No,
do you all know what a flapper is?
Yeah.
Of course you do.
I'm just stupid, don't you?
I thought you were playing that word for comedy value then.
No,
right.
I wouldn't dare. Not on daytime television. I'll leave that sort of thing to Paul. He's not on set, luckily, at the moment, so that's all right. So
we lost track. Anyway, she gets haunted by this flapper and causes trouble. The flapper wants him. And I want him as well. I play a rich bitch. I don't get anywhere near, but the flapper gets quite close. Anyway, it all ends happily.
And it's a ripping good watch, presumably?
Yes, it is. It's got beautiful songs. And
You know, you say that you don't sing the words, and so you presume you have dialogue leading,
yes,
and then a
song. Song.
It's an old-fashioned, yeah.
Is it like the musicals where you can feel a song arriving?
Absolutely.
Oh, here it comes.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's here it comes in a good way. Because it starts sort of during the dialogue and then, you know.
Ah.
It's all done very, very tastefully.
Very tastefully.
Best possible.
And where's that on at the moment?
It's on at the Lyric Theatre in Shaftesbury Avenue. Ah. Maddie is its title.
Have you had any mad moments so far doing it?
And when my wig came off.
Oh, yes, I've forgotten about that, yes.
No, I have never forgotten about that.
Yes, I forgot.
On the first preview, which is very very nerve-wracking because it's like a public dress rehearsal, so we're not really sure what's going on. Well, I'm not sure on the first preview. It's really nerve-wracking. And I've got this most wonderful wig that's a cross between Danny LaRue and
Lily
Lucille
Savage.
Ball. Oh, Lily Savage. Not quite. But I would have done if I'd thought. And it's sort of a wonderful pinky colour and everything. And Graham and I are grappling on a sofa. Well, I'm grappling him onto the sofa at one point. And I banged my head on the sofa. And two hair grips got stuck in the cushion. And that's like I said, that the wig went... So I had pink Danny LaRue to here, then I had a few pink curls belonging to Lynda Baron at the front. And I'm desperately trying to pull it back on. And Summer Rongley, who was supposed to be very upset that her husband's grappling with a woman, opened the door and went, So I was in the naughty book, really. But it wasn't my fault. It was you. You were too much of a brute with us.
Innocent.
Do you like musicals? Have you done many musicals before?
Yeah, I seem to have survived on musicals for the last few years. I finished Sunset Boulevard this April, and Les Mis. I mean, who hasn't done Les Misérables? You've been Madame Tenardier.
People keep saying Madame Tenardier. It's been on too long.
Yeah, I know. Miss Saigon and a few others.
You've done the whole
being very low-key about this. The leading roles are, lads, yeah. Isn't that right?
He's a brilliant singer. You've got a beautiful voice. Yeah. Makes you cry.
Is that because you come from a strong background of music?
It would seem so, yeah. I mean, my parents are both teachers, but my sister's an opera singer, and my father was a choir master and organist and all that, so I suppose we've got it all from him, really. But nobody was professional before my sister and I, so...
Gosh, and where do your family live?
Liverpool.
So they're all right for tickets when they come down to this part of the world, then? You can get...
Oh, yeah, we sort them out. because they like to follow us and like to see what we're doing. Of course, my sister, being in opera, she's all around the world, and whereas I tend to sort of stay in London, so they're always travelling off to... They're in Paris last week, and I don't know where they were before that. They're all over the place, so, yeah.
Fabulous. Well, look, thank you very much for coming in and telling us all about the new musical.
Pleasure.
Glad to hear that the songs are good fun and
aren't pointed out
too much. Yeah. And there's talking in between, which are much better than all the
songs. Yes, and funny as well.
Makes far more sense. Ladies and gentlemen, Lynda Baron and Graham Bickley. Thank you.